a great pleasure today to introduce Josh Freeman. So Josh got his undergraduate degree in physics at Stanford University, and then he came here and got his PhD, and he was my first PhD student. And as I like to tell people, he's one of my two best students. And I have to say that because some of my other students are in the room. And so Josh left, did his PhD here, went on to Stanford, where he did his postdoc at SLAC, and then he came back to Fermi Lab in 1988. And in 1989, he became a part-time, he's a visiting assistant professor, and now he's a part-time professor here. So he started this association with our faculty back in 1989. One of his most highly cited papers is called Natural Inflation. And I think it may be the most cited model of inflation. It was written with Angela Olinto and Catherine Fries. And it really has legs. It's a very important paper. But today, he's going to reveal another aspect of his contributions. Josh is one of the pioneers in survey science. So he's going to tell us about the dark energy survey. But you're all reading my email here. I thought I would, Josh just recently participated in a show where he described what survey science is all about. And it's actually quite nice. So I thought I would just play about 1 minute of that as an introduction to your talk. I assume you've seen this, maybe you haven't. So it's called The Grand Journey to Understand the Evolution of the Universe. The person who directed this is Thomas Lucas, who you may or may not have heard of him. Telling us what a survey is.
Cosmic surveys, which involve large teams of astronomers, really getting together to try to address these fundamental questions about gravity, space, atomic dark energy, and dark energy.
On the dark energy survey, once the camera in the sky, you can take a few hundred pictures of the sky. It takes a picture recorded at a given point on the sky,
and then we shift to the next place in the sky we want to take a
picture of. So over time, we form a kind of a mosaic that covers about 80 of the sky, 5,000 square degrees. The dark energy survey, in some ways, is a successor to a And in many ways, the dark energy survey itself was a forerunner to a project that was started in the 1920s.
I think we hopefully you got the idea of the video. It's a very nice video. It's on YouTube. And Josh is one of the pioneers in survey science. Voyager, really, should I unplug my computer or something? Let's see, is this, that's better, okay. So before I screw up the rest of your talk, Josh Freeman is going to tell us about the results, the first results from the dark energy survey.
Okay, any questions? Actually, I haven't seen that video. All right, cool. Um, It's a pleasure to be back in Chicago. Okay, that's it for the jokes. All right. Today I want to talk to you about some of the early results from the Dark Energy Survey, a project which really in many ways had its origins here at Chicago, particularly grew out of discussions about the need for optical follow-up for the South Pole Telescope, and that led eventually to a bigger project, but that really got its start here with discussions within the KICP, and the KICP is really still a strong, important anchor for the project. So just to remind you where we are in cosmology these days, we have this beautiful or strange Landes cold dark matter cosmological model. It has only six basic parameters in it, and the essence of it is what I think most of you are familiar with. The universe is expanding from a hot, dense early phase, the Big Bang, 13.8 billion years ago. It underwent, we think, an early epoch of accelerated expansion that we call inflation, which produced nearly smooth and flat spatial geometry, but through quantum mechanics generated large-scale density perturbations, which under the action of gravitational instability grew into the large-scale structure that we see today. And that works if the universe contains about 25% cold dark matter and 70% in a cosmological constant or vacuum energy, the remaining 5% in variance. And because of this, it's again currently dominated by dark energy, it is again accelerating. So the universe is going through its second phase, we believe, of cosmic acceleration. And this simple picture and this six parameter model is basically consistent with all data we have from the cosmic microwave background, large scale structure, strong and weak gravitational lensing, supernovae clusters, and light element abundances, among others. So it's quite impressive. Of course, this model rests on physics that we don't yet understand. Inflation, dark energy, and dark matter all require physics beyond the standard model of particle physics. And understanding the physics underneath these phenomena is really a major goal of the Kaplan Institute for Cosmological Physics here. The set of questions I'm going to be focusing on and the Dark Energy Survey was really designed to address is the question of what is the origin of the current epoch of cosmic acceleration? Is it due to dark energy, or does it indicate that perhaps we need to replace our understanding of gravity and general relativity on the largest scales? If it is dark energy, is it this vacuum energy, this cosmological constant, or perhaps something dynamical? And so these questions are really the focus of the dark energy. One way to get at these is to also ask, are the six parameters of the Landes CDM model, are those all we need to really precisely describe the cosmological observations? Or instead, might there be a small trace of spatial curvature, neutrino masses, some kind of dynamical dark energy, or again, modification of gravity? And some of the motivations for these kinds of extensions to the Landes CDM model come about because there are some sort of perceived tensions between some aspects of cosmological measurements that I'll refer to next. So this is one example of a plot put together by Wendy Friedman and her collaborators showing different measurements of the current expansion rate of the universe as a function of publication year. And the local measurements, distance scale measurements, are shown in blue, and they're coming out at around 73 kilometers per second per megaparsec today. And the microwave background measurements, which assume the Landes CDM model, are now coming in sort of in the high 60s. And so there's now a bit over a 3 sigma discrepancy between those two measurements. So the question is, are there systematic uncertainties in one or the other of these kinds of measurements? Or is this discrepancy perhaps telling us that the model that is underlying the CMB measurements needs to be extended or replaced? There are other sorts of tensions that people have pointed to in the last few years. This is just one example. So this is sigma 8. This is just a measure of the amplitude of fluctuations of the large-scale mass density as a function of omega matter, the density of non-relativistic matter in the universe. Here are the results from Planck from the CMB, and here in green are results from a recent weak lensing survey called KIDS. This is a survey ultimately covering 1,000 square degrees, but this is results from their 450 degree survey. And so there's some hints of tension between the weak lensing measurements, either preferring lower clustering amplitude or lower density of non-relativistic matter compared to the Planck CMB results. And again, we'll come back to this later. So talking about dark energy, we can't avoid talking about the equation of state parameter, W. That's the thing, it's the ratio. If I think of dark energy as a new component with a stress energy tensor and therefore a pressure and energy density, then many of the important properties can be summarized in this equation of state parameter, W, the ratio of the pressure to the energy density. And through the conservation of energy momentum equation, for any component of the universe, its equation of state parameter is what determines how the density of that component evolves. So here's the densities of non-relativistic matter and of radiation. A is the cosmic scale factor. And here's what the density of dark energy, how it would evolve. And if this parameter W is constant, this is the scaling, the scale factor of the dark energy density. The defining property of dark energy is that it has an equation of state parameter W less than minus 1/3 and dominates over currently over matter and radiation. So we're sitting out here today, and that's what leads to accelerated expansion. And this was, as of a number of years ago, sort of a rough estimate of where dark energy might lie in terms of its equation of state parameter. The thin blue line, which runs horizontally across here, is the case for W exactly equal to minus 1. In that case, the dark energy density is exactly constant, and that's equivalent to a cosmological constant. So even though in the standard lambda CDM model, the dark energy density is a constant, the equation of state parameter W is exactly minus 1, there are alternative possibilities. Dark energy instead could be due to a very light scalar field, dynamically evolving in its potential. And this idea for dark energy, a scalar field, is really inspired by our sort of standard ideas about what might be driving the much earlier epoch of accelerated expansion, namely primordial inflation. So you can imagine that just as we imagine that primordial inflation is driven by some very massive scalar field, this late current epoch of acceleration could be driven by an extremely light scalar field. You can work out what the energy density and the pressure is for an evolving scalar field. The energy density is just the sum of the kinetic and the potential energies. The pressure is the difference between them. And if this field is evolving slowly enough, the stress energy is just dominated by the potential energy, the pressure will be negative. And that's precisely what we need to drive accelerated expansion. So one thing we want to do is, in one way to couch what we're part of what we're trying to do with surveys like the dark energy survey is to constrain the dark energy equation of state parameter. That's just one way to think about it, but it's a useful way to sort of quantify what we're trying to do. So we have two basic kinds of things that we're trying to get at with cosmic surveys to constrain dark energy. Two handles. One is just measuring the expansion history of the universe. How has the expansion rate changed as a function of look-back time or redshift? And as I vary, for example, the amount of matter in the universe or the dark energy equation of state, I will change cosmic distances versus redshift. So in this case, I'm measuring things like the Hubble diagram, distance versus redshift, trying to figure out which of these curves I may lie on. And that will constrain some combination of the dark energy equation of state and the density of non-relativistic matter. And this is sort of the canonical old school way of doing things. This is what, for example, the supernovae tell us. But in recent years, with the advent of large cosmic surveys, we've opened up a second avenue to probing dark energy using the growth of structure. So the idea here is to just look at the amplitude of clustering on large scales and see how it evolves as I go back in redshift or back out in redshift or back in cosmic time. And again, the equation of state parameter here, again, I'm just assuming simple models where that parameter is fixed, will change the rate of evolution of the density perturbations. And therefore, and that's something I can measure by just measuring the amplitude of clustering, say through low order correlation functions or power spectra. So this is a second approach. And in a cosmic survey, we really want to implement both expansion history and growth of structure probes, because we want to compare them to each other. In the context of general relativity with dark energy, there's a consistency relation between these two things is evident from here. If instead it's not dark energy, but something going on with gravity, then the consistency between these two, predicted by general relativity, can be broken. And so that's why we want to have both geometric probes of expansion history and growth of structure probes, and compare them to try to get at this question of what's really the physics underlying cosmic acceleration. And the challenge is that we're trying to measure these things now with percent level precision, and that's just hard to do. So in dark energy survey, there's sort of four primary things we're trying to measure to get at that each of which is sensitive to different combinations of expansion history and growth of structure. So the first one is the abundance of galaxy clusters. Basically, we're using clusters as stand-ins for massive halos of dark matter. And here's a theory prediction for simply the number of clusters or dark matter halos you would expect to find in a 4,000 square degree survey out as a function of redshift. If you could observe all dark matter halos or all clusters above a given mass threshold. The three different curves are for three different values of the equation of state parameter. So if I can just count clusters in a given area out as a function of redshift, just that census alone will give me some handle on dark energy. At low redshifts, the differences between the curves are dominated by the geometric factor. At high redshift, the differences between these curves, which inverts, is primarily due to the differences in the growth of structure in those different models. The challenge here is, of course, we don't observe dark matter halos directly. We can observe luminous clusters, and we have to understand the relationship between whatever observable we have about those clusters and the mass of the underlying dark matter halo in which they sit. Fortunately, we have a number of different observables that we can attack. In DES, we have just the optical richness of the clusters, how many luminous galaxies they contain, as well as weak lensing masses on a statistical basis. We pair that with the South Pole Telescope, which can measure the Sun-Yale-Zondowicz flux decrement from clusters. And by putting those together also with X-ray measurements, velocity dispersions, etc., we can constrain these sorts of relationships. Second kind of probe is weak gravitational lensing. Here we're measuring the shapes of distant galaxies. Those shapes are distorted because the light, as it travels through the foreground dark matter distribution, gets bent by gravity. That leads to a shearing of the apparent shapes of distant galaxies. And the shears of galaxies nearby in the sky will be similar to each other because the foreground mass distribution has a coherence scale. And so by measuring this cosmic shear, or the two-point correlation of the shapes of background galaxies, we can also, that pattern is dependent both on the expansion history and on the growth of structure. So an example of the kind of measurement you do here is to measure the cosmic shear angular power spectrum in bins of source galaxy redshift. So here's an old theory prediction. This idea of using this technique to probe dark energy really goes back to work by Wayne Hooter, Dragon Hooter, when he was here as a student, and a number of others since then. So here's the cosmic shear angular power spectrum as a function of angular multipole in the sky for source galaxies in several different redshift bins. Here's nearby galaxies, more distant galaxies, the cross correlation between the two. And these two different curves here are predictions for different values of this equation of state parameter. The points in the middle are for lambda CDM. And these are sort of characteristic error bars that you would expect for a survey like DES. Third technique is baryon acoustic oscillations. This is the same physics at the epoch of recombination that imprints on the CMB, and it leads to a sort of characteristic pattern in the angular power spectrum, or a characteristic scale in the two-point function of galaxies on large scales. And so again, if I can measure the angular clustering of galaxies in several different redshift bins, then the positions of these peaks and troughs in the angular power spectrum will be indicative of the dark energy equation of state current. So this is a third kind of technique. And the fourth technique is the one that was, of course, used to discover cosmic acceleration. Type 1a supernovae as standardizable candles give us relative distance estimates. So the Hubble diagram, distance modulus versus redshift. Here is an example. If I take the residual around, say, the Lambda CDM model, then you get this kind of predictions, again, as I vary the equation of state parameter or the amounts of dark matter or dark energy. And so what this is showing you is that to get down to high precision in measuring the equation of state parameter, we need to get down to percent level precision in measuring cosmic distances versus redshift. All right, so those are sort of the four principal techniques that we've designed the dark energy survey around. In order to implement those techniques, we built a camera, the dark energy camera at Fermilab, installed it on the Blanco 4-meter telescope, the Cerro Tololo, back in 2012. And in exchange for delivering this instrument as a facility instrument to NOAO, we were awarded 525 nights on the telescope over 5 years to carry out a survey that could implement those four observables. And so we're doing two surveys. One is a wide area survey over 5,000 square degrees in five passbands from G to Y to a depth of about 24th magnitude. That should give us measurements for on the order of 300 million galaxies. And then we interleave this wide area survey with a supernova survey, a time domain survey, that revisits 10 different fields on the sky roughly every 6 nights and will allow us to discover and measure light curves for several thousand type 1a supernovae. So this kind of survey of this scale simply couldn't have been done with existing facilities. It required a new wide-field camera on an intermediate-class telescope at a good astronomical site, and that's what we've been able to do. I should say that the project has been led by Fermilab and is strongly supported by both the Department of Energy and the National Science Foundation. The survey itself started in August of 2013. Our observing seasons go from roughly mid-August to mid-February. 105 equivalent nights each season, and we're now in the fifth of our 5 seasons. It's not just a U.S. project. We've built an international collaboration of about 400 scientists from 26 institutions in 7 countries, including both Europe and Australia, which makes phone cons challenging to schedule, but a truly international collaboration. Every 6 months, the collaboration gets together, as many of us as we can, and our most recent meeting was here in this building, hosted by KICP in June. We had about 175 collaborators, and we meet for about a week, and it's very important to making progress. I should mention that since May of 2014, we've submitted or published over 135 journal papers, which is not bad. As I mentioned, there's a strong contingent of people here working on the dark energy survey. This is the names that I could come up with. I hope I've included everyone. Those in green are graduate and undergraduate students. So it's really a tremendous activity here. And the work here at Chicago is really quite important to the success of the project. And we collaborate closely with colleagues at Fermilab and elsewhere. So this is what the focal plane of the camera looks like, 570 megapixels, 3 square degree field of view, and 70 2K by 4K fully depleted thick CCDs with excellent quantum efficiency, particularly in the red end of the optical spectrum. That focal plane then sees light that's come through a five-element optical corrector, and Steve Kent and Mike Ladders from here were central in the optical design of the corrector. And here's Steve making a precision measurement of the radius of the largest element of the corrector and verifying that it had the right size and shape. That was before it was polished, and then after it was polished, people wearing funny masks made more precise checks of it, and then it was installed on the optical corrector itself, shipped down to Chile. And there it was installed at the prime focus of the Blanco 4-meter telescope. So light comes in from the sky, bounces off this 4-meter mirror, goes up through five elements, five lenses, and then hits as detected by the focal plane. Just one thing about thing to note, the design of this is somewhat novel. You'll see these things here. Those are elements of a hexapod, which can piston the location of the focal plane, the whole system relative to the primary mirror of the telescope. So this enables us to dynamically maintain the system in focus and also correct the alignment due to changes, say, in the shape of the primary mirror as you slew around the sky. And that kind of dynamical adjustment allows us to maintain good image quality throughout the survey without having to stop and take focus frames. It takes advantage of the fact that several of the CCDs around the edges of the field are displaced above and below the focal plane, giving us out-of-focus images of stars, which we can use to determine where the best focus is. So here's an example of a raw TCAM image. Each of these is a 2K by 4K CCD. There are also a few guiding focus chips around the edges, not shown here. There's actually two CCD here, where you see nothing. Those were damaged after the camera was installed on the telescope. And actually one of them sort of mysteriously and miraculously came back to life last year and is back in operation. But since then, knock whatever I can, nothing further has broken, and the camera's been working remarkably well. So it takes pretty pictures on the sky. So basically what we're doing in the dark energy survey is just taking pictures, right? We're just taking pictures of the sky. Every night we take a few hundred pictures, and that's what we're doing. We're basically photographers. And then when you process the images and put different filters together, you get nice pretty pictures of galaxies. Of course, these are the things we're not really interested in. We're much more interested in these very faint, distant galaxies. This is one of the first images we took with the camera on the telescope, essentially first light image of the Fornax cluster, of a relatively nearby cluster of galaxies. The camera works remarkably well. So let me talk a little bit about the survey itself. This is the footprint on the sky of our survey, covering 5,000 square degrees. This is superimposed on a dust map of the galaxy from Planck. So the dark regions are regions away from the plane of our galaxy, where we have minimum dust and also just obscuration from our galaxy. And so we designed the survey to be at high galactic latitude as possible to minimize the effects of extinction in our own galaxy. It's in this part of the sky because this is the part of the sky we can see from the southern hemisphere. We particularly want to cover this region, which is the 2,500 square degree region of the South Pole Telescope survey. And then we also wanted to cover this region up here called Strike 82. That's the southern celestial equator. And we wanted to overlap with that region because that's where the Sloan Digital Sky Survey has quite a bit of imaging. And so to intercompare our calibrations, we wanted that. Also, this is the part of the survey which is accessible for follow-up to northern telescopes. So for people doing spectroscopy, And there's a lot of information and ancillary information there as well. And then this region in between just connects these two and fills out our footprint. In addition to the wider survey, we have these 10 little white dots. Those are the supernova fields, each of them about 3 square degrees. And we revisit them, again, roughly every 6 nights. Two of these are deeper fields where we take multiple longer exposures. 8 of them are shallower fields. And our plan for the wide area survey is to cover the entire footprint by the end of the survey, 900 seconds in each of G, R, and I, and Z, 450 seconds in the Y filter, and just build depth over time. So, I'll start this and we'll see. Michael showed a little bit of this from that movie. So this is a time lapse of our coverage of the survey, the wide area survey, I think through the first 3 years. So basically, as we start in August 2013, you're seeing when we took a given shot on the sky. And basically, in the first year, we were mostly focused on this part of the sky, the South Pole Telescope region. And then in the second and third years, we filled in this region, and you're striking 82 here, it's upside down. Early part of the season, we focus on the western part of the footprint. And then in February, we're mostly the eastern part of the footprint that's accessible. And now this is just a zoom in to give you a sense of the very wide dynamic range that you have in this kind of data set. And this is a film put together by our colleagues at NCSA down in Berlin. So this is where what we had done after the first year of the survey. And basically, we had covered a good chunk of this South Pole Telescope region, G, R, I, Z, and Y, a few times in each of those filters. That was by design. And then in the second year of the survey, we primarily concentrated on filling in this complementary region. And then in the succeeding years of the survey, we're covering the entire region, but fewer times in each filter. So in a typical year, starting with year 3, our goal is to get 2 timings in each filter over the whole footprint, and then just build up depth over time. So this is where we were as of last night in terms of coverage. The color scale has changed, but you can see that in the western part of the footprint, in most of the filters, we've covered 8 or 9 tilings. Again, the survey is complete when we finish 10 tilings. And in the eastern part of the footprint, we've mostly done 7 to 8 tilings. So we expect by the end of February of 2018 that most of this area will be pretty close to dark blue, so about 9 tilings. And then our plan is to come back in the fall, the northern fall of 2018, and do an extra half season to basically finish off the 10 tiling survey. We're behind for a couple of different reasons, but the main one is that during our third observing season, you may recall there was a very powerful El Nino that year, and that is strongly correlated with worse than typical weather in Chile. And so that set us back quite a bit. Okay, so let me talk about the analysis that we came out with this August, the year 1 cosmology results. We call these 3 cross 2 because we combined measurements of 3 different 2-point correlation functions to constrain cosmology. So the first one is galaxy angular clustering. So we defined a sample of luminous red galaxies in 5 redshift bins, measured their angular clustering on the sky. The second measurement is this cosmic shear weak lensing, correlating the shears of galaxies. For this, we're using shape measurements of 26 million galaxies in 4 redshift bins. And then the third measurement is to combine these two, use the red galaxies as foreground lenses, and measure the shapes of the source galaxies, the tangential shearing of those source galaxies around the foreground lenses. So that's called galaxy shear correlations or galaxy-galaxy lensing. So this is what we published on August 3rd in 10 papers. We did this analysis fully blind, and the results were only unblinded to us in early July. In order to do this kind of analysis, we had to develop a number of new analysis techniques that I don't really have time to talk about, but I'm happy to answer questions about. But particularly in the area of weak lensing, those are measurements that are very challenging to make. There's lots of systematic errors that you have to worry about. And so we really sort of had to develop cutting edge techniques for measuring galaxy shapes and inferring shear from them. And I think we really set a new standard for control of systematics in this kind of analysis. So here's what the two primary samples we used look like. This is the distribution of over 600,000 luminous red galaxies. These have very excellent, very precise photometric redshift estimates. These are the ones we measure their angular clustering, and these are also the lenses for the background galaxies for galaxy-galaxy lensing. This is the distribution on the sky of the much more numerous 26 million source galaxies. These are the ones whose shapes we measure for weak lensing, and then we also combine the two. So the fiducial area that we end up with after analysis cuts is about 1,300 square degrees. One important feature in this kind of analysis is what are called photometric redshifts. We want to be able to measure these two-point correlation functions as a function of redshift. Because this is an imaging survey, not a spectroscopic survey, our redshifts are approximate, so they're called photometric redshifts. And the basic idea is to figure out how to convert five magnitudes that you have, or any other measurements you have for a single galaxy, into some kind of estimate of its redshift. These days that's done probabilistically, so you have some probability distribution function for redshift as a function of those five magnitudes, their errors, anything else, any other sort of measurement you have about that object. And this kind of relationship is typically precise enough. So for typical galaxies, our typical error is about 0.1 in redshift. But the challenge is that, and basically, of course, this works because galaxies have characteristic features in their spectra which change as you go up from low to high redshift. That changes the observed colors of those galaxies. But of course, not all galaxies have exactly the same features, so there's some degeneracy between even five magnitudes and the redshift estimate, which leads to errors and uncertainty. So this is normally done in two ways. You either have a set of galaxies for which you have both these magnitudes and the redshift spectroscopically, and you train an empirical relation, or you have a set of galaxies, you basically span the population of known spectra, use those to define templates, and redshift them until you get the best fit. In either case, there are degeneracies there leading to uncertainties. And this is compounded by the fact that for the training set method, we simply do not have complete spectroscopic training sets out to the depth of our survey. That's why we're doing a photometric survey, because it's fast and cheap compared to a spectroscopic survey. But the downside of that is that we don't have large spectroscopic, complete spectroscopic samples to train our PhotoZ estimates. Nevertheless, we plunge forward and we have a variety of ways to try to address that. So again, this is the redshift distribution for the two samples we're looking at. This is the redshift, five redshift bins for these red galaxies, so-called red magic galaxies. And they really have very precise redshift estimates due to the fact that they basically all have spectra that look like this. And if you can determine that they're a galaxy like that, then you get a very precise estimate of its redshift just from the colors. So here we're down at below 2% precision, which is quite impressive. And then for the source galaxies, we have a variety of techniques that I'll mention in a second for estimating their redshifts. But essentially what we do is have some estimator that puts them into redshift bins, those are shown here, and then we try to figure out what the true distribution of galaxies, the true redshift distribution is for the galaxies that we placed in those bins. So you can see here, just by eye, that for the red galaxies, the true redshift distributions match very well with the redshift, the photo Z binning that you get from the colors of those galaxies. For the source galaxies, it's a different story. So for the source galaxies, we had, say, for this bin, we thought that the galaxies in orange were all in this range of redshift, but their true distribution in redshift looks like this curve. And so that's just telling you that because of these degeneracies and incompleteness, your redshift estimate, your photo Z estimate, necessarily doesn't capture the actual true distribution of the galaxies. The thing we really care about for cosmology is just this N of Z distributions. We're not so interested in the particular redshift of that galaxy. What we really want to know is that for all the galaxies that I put in this photo Z bin, what is the true N of Z redshift distribution? That's the thing that enters into the cosmology analysis. So we spent a lot of time trying to figure out what the true redshift distribution is for these galaxies. So we put them into a photo Z bin according to some photo Z estimator. In this case, we use something called BPZ. And then we have several techniques for trying to figure out what the true redshift distribution for those is. The two most prominent ones is to use a catalog of galaxies that we overlap with, which have very precise redshifts, either from spectroscopy or, in this case, from having photometry in many, many bands. So the Cosmos Galaxy catalog has been observed in 30 passbands, so that gives you very precise redshift estimates for those galaxies. And we can effectively make a Cosmos-like sample for DES to estimate what the true mean redshift is for galaxies in a particular photo Z bin. A second technique is to use the fact that if our sample overlaps in the sky with some other sample of galaxies whose redshifts are known, we can use the fact that galaxies cluster together spatially to calculate the angular cross-correlation of DES galaxies with those other galaxies. And where those cross-correlations are big, that tells you that the DES galaxies tend to be at redshifts of those other galaxies. So this is called the clustering redshift method, or we abbreviate it WZ. And this is an independent way of estimating what your NMC distribution is. And so for the first year analysis, we had these and other ways of estimating the redshift distributions. And fortunately, they agreed quite well. So this is just an example of that. This is work that Ross Cawthorn here was leading. So basically, in this angular correlation method for DES, the galaxies that we used as our clustering sample with known redshifts was actually the red magic galaxies themselves, because they have very good photo Z estimates. But we needed to make sure that the red magic galaxies, that we really had properly calibrated their redshifts. And so this is work that Ross led, which is coming out soon, basically using spectroscopic samples and cross-correlating with those, say from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, to verify that we reconstruct the correct redshift distributions. Okay, so this is now looking again at the clustering of these red galaxies. Before you make the measurement, you have to worry about systematic effects. And so this is an example of the kind of maps of systematic effects that we created. Basically, as observing conditions change over the course of a night or over the season, that could imprint various kinds of changes in the number of galaxies you will see in different parts of the sky, and that would imprint on the galaxy angular correlation function. So we have to map these out, correlate them with the galaxy positions, and whichever where we see a significant correlation, we have to remove that systematic effect. We were able to do that, and we're able to measure the galaxy angular correlation function in these five redshift bins with high precision, and these are the best fit land CDM models. And you can also cross-correlate galaxies in different redshift bins. All right, so that's the first one, is galaxy angular clustering. The second one is cosmic shear, the two-point correlation function of the shear or the shapes of the galaxies. And again, there we had the source galaxies, four redshift bins of source galaxies. Because shear is a vector, there are two components of the shear correlation function, psi plus and psi minus, that you can measure. And this is just the measurements of those correlation functions, again, for different pairs of source galaxy redshift. So for example, in this case, I'm looking at pairs of galaxies correlating the shears of galaxies that are both in the third redshift pair. And again, the solid curves are showing you the best fit Lambda CDM models. And so here's the inference just from those the two-point correlation function of the shear. This is the same plot I was showing you before, the amplitude of clustering, sigma 8, versus the beta matter. So the old kids results are shown in blue here. The plot results are in green. Our results just from the cosmic shear, from the first shear, are shown in gray. So we're sort of in between, between those two of those. A better way of plotting that, we think, is to scale sigma 8 by this power of omega matter. And then you get something which is more decorrelated with omega matter. And again, here's the Planck results, DS year one, and kids. So again, sort of sitting in between those two. The third measurement, the third of those two-point correlation functions is galaxy-galaxy lensing. So this is correlating position of a foreground red mount magic galaxy with the shapes of those source galaxies, which are distorted by the fact that I have, there's mass associated with those foreground galaxies, which is lensing the background galaxies. And here's, again, the two-point correlation functions in different bins of red magic galaxy redshift. And the different curves are different redshift slices for the source galaxies. And again, the different colors. And the curves are, again, the best fit Lambda CDM, just to the galaxy-galaxy lensing. So again, it's not really three two-point functions. It's in fact many, many two-point functions because we have all these different redshift bins in which to make these measurements. So we now want to combine those together, all those two-point functions, and constrain cosmology. I showed you constraints so far just from cosmic shear, but we want to use the other ones as well. It turns out that you need to spend a lot of time calculating the covariance between those all those different two-point functions. So this is the two cosmic shear components, the galaxy-galaxy lensing, and the angular clustering of the red magic galaxies in different bins of redshift. So this is the model for the covariance matrix, and this is what you need in order to combine those together. So finally, this is what happens when you start to combine those together. So this is that S8 parameter. Again, it's the scaled measure of the amplitude of clustering. And the weak lensing shear measurements, so I showed you that before, compared to kids and Planck, are shown in green. The combination of galaxy-galaxy lensing and galaxy angular clustering is shown in red. And when you combine the two together, you get tighter constraints, that's shown in blue. And this was really sort of our primary result from the year one, from the year one data. So the natural thing to ask is when we combine these together, how does that compare with Planck? So just as we had these maps of galaxies and we're measuring two-point correlation functions from them, Planck, of course, earlier had its nice map of CMB temperature and polarization and had measured a two-point angular correlation function from it. But they only have like, you know, one or two or three, right? They've got like temperature, polarization, CMB lensing. But we have many, many two-point correlation functions. So clearly cosmic surveys of galaxies is the wave of the future. So here's the comparison, the money plot. This is the thing which we unveiled to ourselves on a phone con in mid-July. So amplitude of clustering versus omega matter. Here's the combined DS results, the three two-point functions. Here's the Planck results. When you first look at that, you say, okay, well, they sort of overlap, but they sort of don't. So are these consistent or not? And so we had defined before we did this unveiling to ourselves, we had defined a statistical criterion for deciding whether these results would be consistent or not, using Bayesian evidence. And even though these central values disagree by more than one sigma, according to this Bayesian evidence test, they are both consistent with being drawn from the same universe. And that means that it makes sense to combine them together and get a combined constraints from the DS data and from the Planck data. There's a couple other things I want to point out about this. One is that this is really, I think, for the first time where those of us doing galaxy surveys sort of get to hold our head high in comparison with the CMB. We're used to the CMB having these ridiculously tiny, you know, error contours, and galaxy surveys having these gigantic ones, and always feeling a little bit sheepish about that. But now, at least in this two-dimensional parameter space, you know, we're in the same ballpark in terms of errors. And I think that's quite impressive. Moreover, this is just the first year of our data. We have four more years of data that covers much more area of sky and that goes deeper. And also, this is only using two of the weapons, you know, two of the arrows in our quiver, right? Weak lensing and galaxy clustering. We haven't yet used the cluster abundance or the supernovae. So this is going to get, you know, shrink considerably when we both have the more, use the full data set and use multiple probes. So it's really just a taste of things to come. Nevertheless, we can go ahead and combine those two results together, and that's what you get. And these are the sorts of numbers you end up with when you combine not only with Planck, but also with other LOWC data sets. So I showed you earlier supernova results from the joint light curve analysis, the BAO results from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, which we can combine with as well. And I should also mention that here we haven't done any BAO analysis in DES yet either. And these are the sorts of constraints you get. I think rather impressive error bars. Due to time, okay, one other thing. So that was in the context of Lambda CDM, the standard model. What happens if we now go add in one more degree of freedom and allow dark energy to be not the cosmological constant, but some dynamical thing with an equation of state parameter W that could be different from minus one, but we're still going to hold to be fixed constant in time. In that case, we can carry out the same sort of combined analysis, combining our year one data sets with Planck, and also with the Baryon acoustic oscillations and supernovae from other previous measurements. And again, this is after unblinding. This is the value of W we get. There are actually at least one or two additional significant figures of zero here. It's purely accidental, but nevertheless kind of amusing. And again, though, this has to be said that this is in the context of a model where we've fixed W to be constant in time. Once I let W change to be different from minus one, it's not particularly well motivated to fix it to be constant in time. So you really want to start testing time-varying models. That's something we plan to do once we have a larger data set. Let me skip this because I think we're getting low on time. I want to talk about a few of the other, just mention a few of the other results that both have come out recently or will be coming out soon, particularly highlighting some of the work being done here at KSCP in Chicago. So this is work that Qiwei Chang led. This is a reconstruction of the projected mass distribution from that same catalog of 26 million galaxy shapes. So this is, again, over about 1,300 square degrees in the sky, over dense and under dense regions, inferred directly from weak lensing measurements. And this is by far the largest weak lensing map of large scale structure that's been made. And the nice thing about this map is it's complementary to the kind of information that we had in those two-point angular correlation functions. because here you're like just visually, you know, you can see there's phase information here, right? You can tell where individual things are. And this map also encodes in it, for example, higher order moments beyond the two-point function of the mass distribution that are interesting to look at as well. This is just a correlation, showing a visual correlation of that projected mass map with foreground clusters of galaxies, showing that as expected, many of the peaks in the mass map are associated with foreground galaxy clusters. Shiwei also just recently put out a paper measuring the splashback radius. I don't have time to go into this in detail. This is a phenomenon that was actually predicted by theoretical work done here by Andrei Kravtsov and Benedict Diemer, first measured in the SDSS, and now measured both. This is the essentially stacked galaxy profile around clusters, and the inferred mass profile from leak lensing around clusters. And this kind of feature that you see here is what's predicted from N-body simulations. Whether the position of this feature is at the place where we expect exactly from N-body simulations, I think is still to be determined. One thing that will be coming out in the next few months is another two-point function. I talked about two-point functions within DES. We can also correlate DES with other data sets, in particular, of course, the South Pole Telescope. So if we have a CMB lensing map from the South Pole Telescope, the photons coming from the CMB got lensed because they passed through the foreground mass distribution, some of which is sampled by the dark energy survey. And therefore, we expect there to be a correlation between the distribution on the sky of galaxies that we see in DES and the CMB lensing signal inferred from the South Pole Telescope. And here by eye, this is from just an earlier set of our data, a much smaller area of sky, only 150 square degrees. By eye, you can see that there was a good correlation between the foreground galaxies we mapped and the lensing signal from SPT. We're now repeating this kind of analysis using our full Y1 data set, and that will give us additional cosmological information. I want to spend a couple of minutes just talking about supernovae, since that's something where we have an active group here working on. So again, with this time domain survey, we can essentially program in the discovery and measured light curves of type 1a supernovae. So this is an example of a relatively nearby type 1a supernova light curve in the G, R, I, and Z bands. Those are the points. The curves are model fits. And from those model fits, we infer a distance estimate for that supernova. Here's one at a redshift of 1. It's quite impressive, I think, to be able to get high signal-to-noise light curves for type 1a supernovae at redshift 1 from the ground. So this is really a tribute to these thick red-sensitive CCDs. We have a program of spectroscopic follow-up, 100 nights on the Anglo and Australian telescope, and their field of view perfectly matches the field of view of the dark energy camera. They have a multi-fiber spectrograph, and they're targeting a few live supernovae, but mostly supernova host galaxies, to determine their redshifts. So in supernova cosmology, we're sort of moving into an era from spectroscopic to photometric cosmology. The supernova classification, a type 1a supernova, is a particular spectroscopic classification. But we're moving into an era where we're only going to have spectroscopic confirmation for a small fraction of the supernovae that we measure. And that's what we'll do in our first analysis, coming out, we hope, in January, in time for the AAS. Will be an analysis of 250 spectroscopically typed and confirmed type 1a supernovae for the first 3 years of data. But the main new analysis is going to be putting our full photometric sample from all 5 years, that will be a few thousand photometrically classified supernovae with host galaxy redshifts measured. In that case, once you have a photometric sample, your typing is not as precise because you're using the multi-band light curves instead of a spectrum, so you have to worry about contamination from core collapse supernovae. And Rick Hessler and others here are doing a lot of work to model very precisely that contamination and remove it in order to be able to get precise cosmology constraints. And this is going to be even more important for future surveys like LSST. I just want to mention work also being done here by James Lasker, doing an even more precise job of photometric calibration of these supernovae, taking into account the fact that the spectral energy distributions of these supernovae differ from that of stars, which are typically what you use for calibration. And so taking it, going to that next level of precision, we think is getting us down well below percent level photometric precision for supernova cosmology. Another thing I just want to mention, highlighting work being done here. This is by Jason Poe. In the course of the survey, we're finding many strongly lensed quasars and galaxies. So here's one of the strongly lensed galaxies we discovered in the year one data. So it's in this case, it's actually, I think, a pair of galaxies lensing a more distant background galaxy into an arc. And this is an example of the kind of modeling that Jason is doing to infer the mass distribution and mass to light ratios for these lens galaxies. I think you already heard last year from Alex Domingo-Wagner and Keith Bechtel about the new dwarf galaxies we discovered. So I won't go repeat that, but I just want to mention work that Nora Schiff here is doing, basically using the stellar catalogs from the first 3 year data to infer interesting structures in the Milky Way and its environments as well. Let's see, I'm going to skip over. Okay, well, this is a cool thing. We didn't design the survey to study the solar system, but it turns out to be pretty good for studying the solar system. So this is the 5 year orbits of known trans-Neptunian objects. And because we observe this footprint repeatedly over the course of 5 years, we can actually look for trans-Neptunian objects. So those were previously known ones, but we've discovered, I think, about 50 new trans-Neptunian objects, including the second most distant dwarf planet in the solar system. So that's pretty cool. You get obviously, the cadence in the supernova fields is much higher. So those sort of per unit time give you more of these. But even in the wide area survey, we can find these things. And of course, we've been spending a lot of time trying to find Planet 9, since if it exists, its likely orbit is right in the middle of our footprint. We talked last week about gravitational waves, so I don't think I'm going to repeat that. Except just to remind you that we independently discovered the optical counterpart for this new gravitational wave binary neutron star event discovered by LIGO Virgo, which is pretty cool. And this is basically just a sort of a synergistic observing program that we have with the Dark Energy Survey, measured its light curve, worked with LIGO to infer, and Daniel to infer the Hubble parameter. This was the result they got from just a single event, which is pretty nice. I just want to mention that the story is continuing. So a couple days, I think, after last Monday, put out this result with Dan Skolnick here and others, basically using more information to constrain the inclination angle of the binary orbit of the neutron star, of the gamma ray burst jet relative to our viewing angle, to try to, so basically using radio to X-ray observations to constrain that inclination angle more precisely, and that breaks part of the degeneracy in determining the distance to that event, and therefore gives you a bit of a shift, interestingly, in an upward direction on the Hubble parameter. And I remind you that the nearby measure, the local distance ladder measurements are in the range of around 73. So that's sort of interesting, but again, obviously we're gonna have to wait until we have tens of events here to really nail this down. Okay, where we go from here? We have a few Y1 analyses to wrap up, particularly from galaxy clusters. We have supernova results coming out in the next few months as well. But our focus is really shifting now to analysis of the first 3 years of our data, using all of these techniques and combining them together to get what we think will be extremely powerful constraints on dark energy. But I think even with this first year of data, we've already entered the realm where galaxy surveys are really now no longer the sort of the poor brother of the CMB. I think galaxy surveys now have comparable constraining power to CMB. It's going to get better with our additional data sets, bringing in more probes, and of course with future surveys, DESI, LSST, WFIRST, and Euclid. So we're in fact getting toward the end of our observing period for the dark energy survey, although we're expecting to extend it by another few months later next year. Our first results are out, more still to come in the next few months and then the next couple of years. In addition to the cosmology results, there's all sorts of fun ancillary science that has come out of this, most of which we didn't expect when we first started designing and building it. And finally, I encourage anyone interested here to get involved with us. Or in addition, the data are becoming public, and our first major public data release, DR1, is planned for this December. And that'll be co-added images and catalogs from the first three seasons of the survey. So I think I'll stop there. Thanks.
Thank you, John. That's terrific. Questions?
I'll just play this while we have questions.
They want to see the movie
first. So this is actually made by Bjorn Sørlo, a postdoc at Cambridge, from when he was down observing for us. I should mention that all the observing is carried out by members of the collaboration. We typically have two or three people down on the mountain observing together for typically 5-6 nights. And it's a fun place to visit. This is that's the AO system from Gemini over on Cerro Pachón.
Tom has a question. The H dot tension gets all of the press, but what's your take on the sigma 8 tension? And especially because that's the one where Planck really seems to be the outlier.
So I would say, what is my take?
So he doesn't want Bayes' opinion, he wants Drudge's opinion.
So of course I'm not going to give you my opinion. my opinion is that at the moment, it is statistically consistent.
If you go to the next slide.
If you go to the next slide? What's the next slide?
Yeah, and you look on the left.
Yeah.
And you say one of these things is not like the other.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, but this is only a 1D, right? This is, you have to be careful, it's a 1D plot. I would say I'm not too overly exercised about this because I know that we've got this stuff coming, and so this is going to shrink. And it's either going to shrink around here, in which case we'll say, uh-huh. Or it's going to shrink around here, in which we'll say, eh. And I don't really have a strong prior, personal prior in which way that's going to go. I do know that Planck is going to be coming out, they say, in the next few months with their final results. And one of the things they're going to do is combine with our year one results. But I don't know, I would doubt that this is going to shift very much for them. But we'll see. So that'll be the next thing. But I think the next thing for us will really be analyzing our year three data, bringing in, which is, again, 3 or 4 times the area, so much more volume, bringing in these other probes, and really shrinking this down quite a bit. So I think, you know, now we're in this interesting regime because we're sort of comparable error bars and sort of in agreement, sort of not. But so my view is, you know, just wait. And we will figure this out in the next year or two.
So just an advertisement for the moment of truth. Sylvia Galli will be coming on January 17th to give the colloquium to talk about the final Planck analysis.
Okay,
and so I hope you have that on your calendar so that we can have you in the audience. More questions? Actually, could you go to the next slide? I was trying to take notes and you... The Hubble constant, the combined constraints, I see, that's mainly weighted.
Yeah.
It's a tiny error bar. I guess it's mainly weighted by Planck.
Right. So, yeah. So, so since you asked. So, on our own, we really don't, we have essentially no constraining power from these 3 2-point measurements on the Hubble constant. What we do constrain rather well is omega matter. But here's what you're getting from Planck itself in green, again in the context of Land CDM. We shift it a little bit when you combine it, by maybe over a sigma from their central value, but not up to the local values. And again, you have to be a little cautious. The analysis that we did, there's a subtlety, is we floated the neutrino mass. And there's some degeneracy of neutrino mass with all these parameters. The tradition in this field is for people to set the neutrino mass to a lower bound from oscillations. And so that shifts things up a bit, up and down a bit as well. But yeah, so I would say not a dramatic impact on the Hubble parameter, but a shift towards the local values, but by a small amount. It doesn't resolve it. And it doesn't significant. It doesn't really shrink the error bars.
More questions? Oh, John.
You talk about the point.
The
low 0.6 values and higher 0.7 values. You used the word local and non-local. Is it z of 1 versus
for the Hubble constant? Yeah, so the Hubble constant, the local one, is basically the standard distance letter, CEPI variables plus type 1a supernovae. The high Z is cosmic microwave background.
Andre.
I was just wondering about this Bayesian evidence. So Bayesian evidence, if I understand it, how is it used? Like the Jeffrey Pryor or something like the Jeffrey criterion? Because Bayesian evidence, when you have an evidence for two experiments,
right?
Decision on whether they consist or not is like, they're consistent, they're not consistent. Yeah. Because
that's
you apply some kind,
yeah, so
true.
Right,
I wonder if it's just that, or is there something more rigorous?
No, you're absolutely right. So when you compute the Bayesian evidence, there is a sort of criterion. Jeffries is one, I forget there's another one, there's two different ones. One is named after Jeffries. I forget who the other one is named, which basically says, an evidence ratio larger than a few is, is consistent, less than a few is not. Or it's like a range. But yeah, and so then you have to, what does that mean? That's what this guy Jeffries or whoever came up with. So that's, that's what you're paying the price for using Bayesian.
Where from the Jeffries? The Jeffries scale is like nothing to write about strong evidence. Where is it from the Jeffries scale?
Oh, I don't remember the numbers here. I can look them up in the paper. But so again, what we did is before we unblinded, we said we're going to do this Bayesian evidence ratio test, and we're going to accept values according to the Jeffrey scale, you know, it's either larger or some, than or less than some number, which was two or three, as consistent or not consistent. And because again, it's important to do that beforehand so that you don't decide after the fact what's consistent or not. But I agree, there's different people can disagree about where you should set that value. But we felt we had to set something, right, beforehand so that we could then be consistent. But again, you know, so if you're not Jeffries, if you're someone else, you know, you may not think these are so consistent. But according to the Jeffries scale and the other one whose name I don't remember, and these sort of canonical values people usually use, you know, they're consistent. So again,
I'm trying to understand the logic. So the logic is that they're consistent, therefore the fact that they are outlined, like they're not overlapping, is lucky, because that's what allows you to put this type constraint, right? So you just, they're randomizations of the same thing, but they are not overlapping strongly. So they're overlap regionless, creates this narrow
narrow constraint. So but the way we phrase it is it's not improbable that if the true value parameter values are in here, it's not improbable that we would get parameter values in here and that quant would get values there. But that not improbable is, that's a subjective statement.
The interpretation of the universe is both, you know, time and therefore the part.
Yeah, right. So I agree, different people could adopt different criteria for what is consistent or not. And I don't know of an objective way to do that. So we just had to pick one which was sort of reasonable by the historical standards of the field. And once you pick it, you stick with it once you unblind.
So we have a great reception waiting, and I think the IME students are trying to eat our food, but I have one quick last question that should have a short answer. So the first three seasons of data will be released in December.
Yes.
So you have been teasing us that it's only going to get better. I think that's true. When will the, and now you have all the pipelines running. So when can we expect to see the, I guess you might call them Y3 results?
Good question. I'd like to know the answer to that myself. I'd say definitely calendar year 2018. But what, I'm not going to predict the month.
Okay.
These things always take a little longer than you expect or hope.
But since the data is released to the world, now you're racing the world, right?
In some sense, yes. Although what we're releasing is are basically the co-ed images and very basic catalogs from them. There's a tremendous amount of additional processing that we do that we're not going to be releasing in December. So we're not releasing. You know, weak lensing shape catalogs, photometric redshifts, red magic, or red cluster catalogs, or red galaxy catalogs. So those things we're holding back until we do the analyses, and then we'll make those public.
Well, let's thank Josh again for and actually, we're going to invite the non-PhDs down to ask a question, and I wish I were allowed.